like you hate it now, but wait till you drive it.
The Kivvy and Friends Show.
What it is, bro?
Presented by Holly Performance, makers of the world's best air and fuel delivery systems. Featuring Rob Kivvy.
I don't know how to put this, but kind of a big deal.
Justin Corndog Cornette.
New guy's in the corner puking his guts out.
And show producer Bernie McPartland.
This is the DJ 3000, and it has three distinct varieties of inane chatter.
We're talking cars.
Do you feel this vehicle is safe for highway travel?
Yes, I do.
Diving deep on the topics that matter most.
Just when I think you couldn't possibly be any dumber, you go and do something like this.
And totally redeem yourself!
And the Dukes of Hazzard. Available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and wherever you get your content.
Turn up the volume.
This is the Kivvy and Friends Show.
Kivvy and Friends Show, episode number 209. Available in Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, Google Play, iHeartRadio, Instagram, YouTube, and Patreon. I am your host, Rob Kivvy. With me as... Oh, period. With me, as always, is co-host Justin Corndog Cornette, period.
Yes, I'm here, but in a different location.
You were almost in the glass booth of emotion with our producer, Bernie McPartland, with his guns, his bacon, and his home studio. He's back in the saddle. Bernie, welcome.
Thank you very much. It is so good to be home and back in my normal chair. It's been fun what I've been doing, but it's certainly good to be home and back with you.
So the reason that you were not in the home studio for quite a while was to care for parents. How are the parents?
The parents are doing very, very well. There were two things that happened back to back for those that don't know or haven't been in the loop. First, my mother had knee replacement surgery back at the end of the summer in July-ish. So we had already planned to help out with that the best that we could. And so that happened. And then my father, after that surgery happened and a few weeks into the recovery, my father was diagnosed with some nerve damage in his neck. And so he went through a surgery to correct that. And he has healed enough now that he has gone from not having any balance whatsoever, hardly having to walk with him literally everywhere in the house to hold him up, to where he can now shower himself and walk around on a cane. And is doing outside physical therapy. So we as a family made the decision, things are good enough that we're close enough that we can go ahead and come back home, and things are good.
That's awesome. So good for you and good for them. So everybody listen, this is an automotive and pop culture show, but a portion of this is going to be a pretty good feel-good show. Would you guys like some more good news?
Sure.
Okay, here's some good news. So for those who have been following, we have a Patreon component to this. And Patreon's this extra thing where you guilt people into paying more to hear you, and they just get like one bonus show a month. And sometimes they get other stuff, but we totally cheat it. We give people like next to nothing and just take their money. You understand. But at Christmas, we make up for all of that. And the past few years, we have done a $1,000 Toys for Tots donation. Well, our goal this year was $2,000. And apparently, it's our patrons' goals as well. We have received, since the last episode, another single $500 contribution for Patreon just for this month. That's from Jeff Howard. And we have had several people up their donations, maybe just for this month. I don't know. Doesn't matter to me. But everybody wants to see this happen. So I'm here to tell you, I did the math. We're going to make it. We are absolutely going to make it. I think I'll make the contribution this week.
That is awesome.
So that's awesome. Freaking, it could make you cry, right? I mean, geez.
First week of December, too.
Yeah, we're never on time. This is terrific. So we just want to thank all of you for making this happen. And I've always wanted to film throwing a bunch of toys in the back of Kibby Lee and driving up to the toy place and getting rid of them. But it's always in winter and the car's always in storage and the toy place is a Toyota dealership. And I always just thought that'd be weird. I'm screaming.
Go rent a Prius.
Yes. So what's the point of that? So thank you, everybody. We've got more Patreon news coming up here, but just right off the bat, this is going to happen. There are kids that don't get much, if anything, for Christmas. And I'm guessing that a lot of you, like a lot of us, when you really sit down and count your blessings, you realize you have everything you could possibly need and more. You want truly for nothing. You're not worried about where you're sleeping tonight. I mean, it's awesome. Very good.
Very cool.
We are going to have a little shorter show. I'm a little under the weather here. I know that Bernie hates working, and Corndog is not in his home. He is in, where are you? You really are in Bernie's home town.
Yeah. He's got a nice little guest house right here behind his house. It's very nice.
I've been back there. I recall a shed. Are you in that one?
The she shed?
Is it a
shed? Yeah, he renovated it. It's nice. Little mm-hmm. kitchenette, king yeah. size bed.
I can tell you what I remember. There should be a red Chevelle, a Chevy Colorado, and two Cadillacs.
No, we pushed all of that out to fit the king size bed.
Oh, you're in the garage.
Yeah.
Oh, that too. Okay. That does make sense. All right. Congrats.
That so way he's got heat and air. And if it gets really cold, I'll turn on the dryer and it vents into the garage. And so that'll keep him nice and warm.
Yeah.
Professional body man that you are, you have been sent by your employer to Mercedes-Benz factory training
facility.
So you're there for 2 weeks straight?
Yeah. It's actually in Grapevine, Texas. And Bernie, how far away is that from you in roughly?
I'd call it 25, 30 miles. Not bad. Okay. It sounds like a lot, but it's not bad. It's all 5-lane freeway between us. So it really doesn't take any time at all. It's a big backyard. Yeah.
Yeah. So yes, I'm here for 2 weeks straight doing aluminum welding. So I've done aluminum welding before. You know, I've been certified, ICAR certified or whatever, but this is for Mercedes and they hold a different level than ICAR. The instructor will tell you, forget everything ICAR taught you, because after you leave this course, you will be able to tell the instructor at ICAR what they're doing wrong and teach them something new. So it's totally different. Today, we didn't pull the trigger on the welder, not once, but it was nothing but learning about the metals and how they melt and just it's all, you know, I felt like I was back in science class again. It was interesting.
Was there anything that surprised you? Is metal metal when it comes to cars, or is there something unique?
There again, this is aluminum, so it melts at a different rate that steel does and stainless and all that. So it's very, very particular on how you do it, you know, and one little screw up and, you know, it's no good. They told us what they're going to be looking for as far as how they're going to measure it, and they're going to do a tearaway test. They can do X-ray of the weld and see if it's got any pores in it. I mean, it's pretty in-depth, but that's kind of what they require too. So in the two-week span, I think he said it was 9 different welds, like you'll do a T weld and a butt to butt, and then, you know, just different styles or whatever. And he says at the end of this week, you will have accomplished 2. All of next week, you've got 7 to do. And he has like a big, huge, probably 5 foot by 5 foot and 5 foot deep bin. And that bin will be slammed full of throwaways.
Are you there with people from Mercedes dealerships primarily, or is it all independent shops like yours?
It's both. The dealerships, they don't have as many collision shops, you know, within the dealership, and they'll contract it out to a close by body shop. And so the shop that I work at, we're actually less than a mile away from the dealership, but we do all of their collision stuff. I think he said in the United States, there's 300 Mercedes shops. You start breaking it down, and then long story short, the certification that I'm doing, they call it Elite Certified. And currently there's just a little over 140 techs in all of the U.S. that do it. So,
you can make some more money.
Hopefully. I doubt it, but hopefully.
Like, is this a resume builder? You could shop this around, right?
The certification stays with the tech and not the shop, but your shop doesn't send you there hoping that you go leave and go somewhere else. But because it's a pretty... No, I've actually been there. The next July will be 20 years that I've been there.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Is that common in the body shop industry to be at a single place that long?
No, you've got people that expect there to be a revolving door. That's just not like in the area that I'm in. It's every body shop across the United States and probably other countries as well. You've got techs that will jump from shop to shop to shop. You know, they'll get pissed off at one shop and go to the other because the grass is greener over there. And then they'll get pissed off there and go somewhere else. And so anyways, you've got those techs, and then you've got techs like me that once they get there and you know, you're going to take the good with the bad. So, you know, you've got good days and bad days. So, you know, you just, you're there. So that's kind of the way I've been.
You have quite the philosophy on life.
I've worked at three different shops, though. The other two were actually while I was in college. And, you know, I was just doing the auto collision training at college. And then I would go work part-time at a shop. And it was a two-year course. And my first year, I worked at one shop. The second year, I worked at another shop on the other side of town. And graduated and then started working at the shop I'm at now. And been there ever since.
Shucks, ma'am. I just record generalese and I fix wrecks. You know how it is. That's it. Shucks.
Bring your Mercedes to me.
There's the ching ching I was waiting for. Yeah. Yeah, that ain't free. You guys want to play a quick game? We introduced this game last week, and during the Christmas season, we may as well keep it up. And it was wildly popular, amazingly successful.
Are you light on show content again, boss?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Nope. Okay.
In December, it's quite hard. I got nothing going on here. So. Here we go. This is the a little music here, Baron. The Christmas movie or not, and the car you rode in on. As a reminder, there's only going to be four questions this time. You're going to get a clip. You got to guess the name of the movie for 1 point. You guess whether it's a Christmas movie or not. So that's just true or false. And then you tell me the star car. And we are generous. If you get close enough, you will get the points. You can steal if you just totally blow it. But for the most part, I think you guys are going to get it. Who would like to go first? You guys can pick.
I went first last time, so CD's up.
Okay, here we go. This is for Corn Dog, so fire away.
That hot damn walls is froze up.
Some men are Baptists, others Catholics. My father was an Oldsmobile man.
Son of a bitch would freeze up in the middle of summer on the equator.
Quite a bit of hint in there. I believe you're going to get this without any banter. What do you think that was?
I know I've heard that line before somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
It might have been on TBS maybe 30 times in a single day. That would be Christmas Story.
Yeah, Christmas Story. Okay, Christmas Stories. That is absolutely the name of the movie. Bing, 1 point for you.
I'll go out on a limb and say that it is a Christmas-themed
damn, two movie. For two. He is on fire. En fuego here. Mercedes training has not dulled your senses. And number three, what is the star car in this movie? And specifically, the hot damn Olds.
That's it. It's the Oldsmobile, and I believe it's a 38. I'm not mistaken.
I'll believe 39. You. I did some Googling, and what Google said was 37 Oldsmobile F37-6 touring sedan. I would buy anything you say. It's an Oldsmobile, and it's old.
Good enough.
Good enough.
Bernie, what is the car that you have? It's not an Oldsmobile, is it?
It's not. It's my father's. It's a 36 Chevrolet Business Coupe.
Same era. You know, they all fat fender cars. They look very similar.
Mm-hmm.
It was a four-door sedan, though. I'll definitely know that. So.
Okay, over to you, Bern. Here is your clip. Now, I just happened to watch this movie over the weekend. It had been a long time. I think you'll get this, but who knows?
Where do you live?
In the city.
Do you have a house?
Apartment.
Own or rent?
Rent.
What do you do for a living?
Lots of things.
Where's your office?
I don't have one.
How come?
I don't need one.
Where's your wife?
Don't have one.
How come?
It's a long story.
Do you have kids?
No, I don't.
How come?
It's an even longer story.
Are you my dad's brother?
What's your record for consecutive questions asked?
38.
I'm your dad's brother, all right.
You have much more hair on your nose than my dad.
How nice of you to notice.
I'm a kid. That's my job.
Okay. Familiar voices in there. Very familiar voices. Both of which you have heard in Christmas movies time and time and time again. What do you think you heard there, Brian?
I'm thinking I heard John Candy. I also heard the little kid that I can't pronounce his last name, but he was in a lot of movies for a while. Now he's not.
Yep. Now he's not.
And he got in trouble in a casting trailer and doesn't do movies anymore. The movie was called Home Alone. There was a bunch of them.
Those were the right actors. Are you saying that this movie is Home Alone?
I'm saying this movie is Home Alone.
Ooh, okay. It is not Home Alone.
Yes, you're right. Oh, kill me.
You suck.
This was a loaded.
Hang on, I'm in your backyard. Yeah, I'll try.
Not a trick question.
Oh.
You're thinking John Hughes, which is good. You're thinking John Candy, which is good. But are you thinking Home Alone? Okay, the movie is, Corn Dog, do you know?
Uncle Buck.
Bing.
Uncle Buck.
It is Uncle Buck. Corn Dog with the steel. Okay.
So, can we start over? God.
No, negative. You're suffering amuses me.
I think
the car, wasn't it like, I know it was a big old huge piece of crap that was smoking, and he pulls up to the school to pick up, was it the daughter or something?
Yeah.
Okay. And was it like a mid to late 70s? Was it like a Thunderbird?
It is a 77 Mercury Marquis Brougham.
Marquis. Yes.
With no rear shocks. It's just awesome every time it rolls and on the scene.
Has never been washed.
Not once. Byrne, was it a Christmas movie or no?
It was a Christmas movie. No, it was not a Christmas movie.
It was not. Okay. All right. Byrne's got one there. And then Corndog got one. Go. Okay. Back over to Corndog. Only two questions to go, lasting longer than I thought it would. Okay. Here we go.
Pardon my French, but Cameron is so tight that if you stuck a lump of coal up his ass, in 2 weeks you'd have a diamond.
A short clip, but a famous clip. You need to hear it again?
Yes.
Pardon my French, but Cameron is so tight that if you stuck a lump of coal up his ass, in 2 weeks you'd have a diamond.
Woof. So he's talking about somebody named Cameron, who is very tight, and if you stuck a lump of coal up his...
That sounded like Ferris Bueller.
Bing! It is Ferris Bueller. Nice. Would you say you Ferris go. Bueller is a Christmas movie? Yes or no?
Far from it.
Again, right? And what is the star car in
And
Ferris
we'll
Bueller?
Go with the little Ferrari.
Yes, the 1961 Ferrari.
What was the model?
It's a 1961 Ferrari 250 GT California.
Okay. California.
And the one in the movie was obviously fake, although the insert shots were of a real car.
The jump car was probably a Miata or what? Who knows what?
I think. All right, Byrne, back to you. You can't necessarily catch him at this point, but I think you'll go out in a blaze of glory here. So here is yours. I actually got two here. I didn't know which one would work better for you. Let's try this one.
The point is, how do you know the fairy isn't a crazy glue sniffer? Build a model airplane, says the little fairy. Well, we're not buying it. He sneaks into your house once, that's all it takes. Next thing you know, there's money missing off the dresser and your daughter's knocked up. I've seen it 100 times.
But why do they put a guarantee on the box then?
Because they know all they sold you was a guaranteed piece of shit. That's all it is, isn't it? Hey, if you want me to take a dump in a box and mark it guaranteed, I will. I got spare time. But for now, for your customer's sake, for your daughter's sake, you might want to think about buying a quality product from me.
But, all right, Byrne, that's as good as it gets. What's the name of the movie?
It is not Home Alone. It is Tommy Boy.
Ding, it is. Is that a Christmas movie, would you say? It is happy and hopeful.
It is happy and hopeful. There is snow, but there is no, not a Christmas movie.
Ding, correct. And what's the star car?
A blue rusty GTX.
Is it rusty?
In parts.
Filthy. Road grimed
and surface rusty.
I'm sure it was rusty up underneath.
The Tommy Boy review goes down in the Kibbe and Friends Hall of Fame. Maybe the most requested rerun we've done. Right up there with Smokey and the Bandit. But definitely our favorite.
Really?
Yeah. Okay, that's it. Corndog wins this round. We'll have one more next month. By month, I mean week. Patreon people, I'll let you know up front, we're going to get the $2,000 goal. Just wanted to say thank you to a few people who are doing some upgrades. Middleman just edited his pledge from $5 to $20. Josh Hicks went from $2 to $5. Jeff Howard was at the $20 level, and his level says $520. So I contacted him real quick, and I said, hey, just so you know, right now you're paying $520 a month. And I assume that's not, you just want to do the one-time thing. He goes, yeah, that's what I want to do. So I assured him, like, if it gets charged, we'll do a quick refund. But when you add that up between that and Dan Atkinson and other monies that we saved up all year, we're going to do it. So we're absolutely going to do it, which is just terrific. So every single December, we have a quad-hosted show. Typically, it's Dan Atkinson that does that. But this month, Dan wanted to give it away. The quad host part, that's what I mean. So he not only paid a contribution.
We hope. We hope that's what he meant.
We're taking the money and running, and we're asking no questions. But Mr. Corey Seifert won it. So Corey Seifert will be here with us as one of our longest contributing patrons to quad host the Christmas show with us. That will run the actual week of Christmas. So sounds good. That's all coming up here shortly. If you'd like to join in, patreon.com/KF show is where you go.
Do you think he's going to do to this show what, if you remember, when Robin Williams, more committee, you know, he used to be on the Johnny Carson show, what he would do, he would completely take over that show and just take it away from the host and just make it fabulous. Same thing if you put Ted Nugent on the stage on a show, he would just take it over. I wonder if that's going to happen to our show.
One way to find out.
You saying I can't hold the reins on here, Byrne?
I'm saying it's possible, depending on the guest. We know nothing about the hosting skills or the impulsive comedic activity of this one great man.
That's true.
We better be careful.
The longer people listen, the better they get good with the rhythm. So he probably could just slide right in here and do the work.
Mm-hmm.
Work.
Yeah, yeah.
Work is a four-letter word. With that, it is time to go to the award-winning, all-pleasing, making-upping, kind of boring at times, Bernie on the News. This is where Bern carves the internet for the news you need to know, gives you back what's left over. Hopefully it's worth something. Welcome, Bern. Go ahead.
It's going to be depressing, but we'll start on a high note.
Oh.
Calling all fans of Christmas movie classics. You know, we have the Christmas Story house that one of your goals, Rob, is to spend the night in that house at one point.
It is. Next Christmas, I want to do it.
Well, and this is where I got my foul up earlier in our game show segment. The Home Alone house in Winnetka, Illinois, is going to be available to do the same thing. It's available to rent through Airbnb for one night later this month, December. The stay is only $25. It's open to four people, and it includes junk food, booby traps, a film screening, another holiday hijinks. It's what? Also going to be accompanied by the big brother who's going to come and make an appearance, quote
Buzz?
Unquote.
Buzz.
Yes.
That's Buzz funny. Will make with an or appearance. Without the tarantula?
Tarantula will be let loose. That is one of the facts. Yes.
Good. Good.
So I know there's a $25 thing. Is there a charity giveaway or is it a maze thing or what? Do you know the background?
I think it's just to support a foundation that the rental company is supporting with this, I believe. It's a pub stunt, as they most are.
I wonder what it's dressed out like in there, because they didn't film the interior for that movie in that house. I wonder if they've updated it.
Hmm. Oh, that would be so cool. Know.
I saw something one time of that house. They showed the inside of it. There again, it's kind of like the Christmas Story house. It's not the same, but it's very similar. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure since Home Alone, they've gone in there and maybe redecorated it to look more like the actual interior.
I hope so. There's this thing on Netflix called The Movies That Made Us. Watch Home Alone sometime. And when they realized they couldn't film in the house, they built it out in a gym. Same high school, I think, that they did several other John Hughes movies. But the colors, I mean, the wallpaper is specific. Everything's red and green. Everything somewhere is Christmased up. It's awesome. I love stuff like that.
Yeah. Let's record there next Christmas.
Ooh.
Now, there's an idea. Yeah. We can't even record at SEMA yet. We can't even do a live show from there yet.
We'll get pizza delivered, cheese only, and they've got to knock down the little statue when they pull in.
Get the Homney. Mm-hmm. Dodge Homney.
Yeah. California is losing an icon. This is where we enter the depressing part of the newscast tonight. Auto Club Drag Strip is part of the motor complex that includes, I believe they have a 2-mile oval track there as well. Officials with the track say they'll be closing the quarter mile that suffered one closure from a judge earlier who closed the track over noise complaints from the neighborhood nearby. Then the death cloud hit, and now that's the end of it. So long for that. That leaves California with a couple of still major tracks. I can't think of all of them. I believe Irwindale is one. I can't remember the name of the other one. Another death from COVID, I believe we could chalk it up to. And finally,
brother's love is... a brother's love.
I believe. Not having a brother, but I can only assume. Not only paternal brothers, but what about your brothers in your car club, even your motorcycle club? Is there a way that we with brothers can go too far with our brotherly love, either in person or in their memory? Well, let's find out. Rick is the subject of our talk today. Rick was in a motorcycle club and tragically lost his life a couple of weeks ago. Rick was on his way to another funeral, in fact, when the tragedy happened. Ceremony was held. His family and friends said goodbye. But then, because they missed him and they longed for that just one more time experience that we've all experienced and felt some remorse about, his bike brothers decided to take action. They dug him up. They dug Eric up. They opened Eric's casket, and with some help from four or five of Eric's Ecuadorian closest friends, they put him on the back of a motorbike, and then they let the good times roll.
This is real.
This is real. Yeah. Eric can be seen in the video being driven away with his white burial shirt opened up because it's hot in a casket, and with his bandaged wound still in full view, driving away, with the crowd cheering and horns honking. Have a great ride, Eric. The police have tagged this in Ecuador as unhealthy activity, quote, quote, and no comment on how they plan to put the goods back where they found him. A brother's love is a brother's love.
You guys being cremated? You have plans? Well, let's just discuss this up front.
I'm rethinking them now, whatever they were.
I don't want to do any of that. I like you guys, but this is no.
Maybe we should have a pact, you know? Whoever's left has to do this to the other.
No.
We can call it Weekend at Bernie's.
We could. We and for that reason, we now probably have to, don't we?
Yeah.
Terrible news, Bern. You have any others?
That's interesting.
In other deaths, the Big Ragu, as he was called, Eddie Mecca. He played Carmine. He was the dancing guy and love interest on Laverne and Shirley. Eddie was 69. And birthdays, good actor Jeff Bridges, 72 years old. Good model Tyra Banks, 48. Lucy Liu's 53. And corndog favorite Britney Spears has hit the big 4-0. Congrats, guys, on the victorious Free Britney campaign.
Leave Britney alone!
Soon she'll be old and broke like all of her fan club.
I remember she came, like, she was just like the smoke show hottest thing. But that changed.
Now she's 40. Yep.
Yep. That totally changed. Terrible news, Byrne. Didn't enjoy it. So
thank you.
He did like the Britney part, though.
Delivered well. Just like to remind you that this show is presented for now by Holly. And we like Holly a lot. Let me throw something at you here. So I am really kind of wanting to do a Gen 3 Hemi swap. Now, I noticed Corndog picked up a little donor vehicle. Maybe. He got it. Now, is that Charger that you bought for you, or is that another purchase for another
buddy? No, that's basically stirring the pot, I guess you could call it. No, my friend from Australia, he bought it, and it got shipped to my work, and I took it home. But it's a 2010 5.7 Hemi Charger cop car.
Maybe I read this from you, but is it true that those don't like being idled around?
Yes.
Like for days and days and days, like security guards.
Yeah, in the comments, someone said something about, oh, the motor must already be blown up or whatever. And it's not. It actually left two beautiful patches in front of my house. I don't know how they got there, though. Huh. But it's still very powerful. So I don't know if that's the original engine to the car or what, but it's a good run and driving car. My work, you know, we've got a full mechanical department over there as well. We were getting a lot of cars from a local hospital, a lot of 5.7 Hemi Charger cop cars. A lot of them, they were wiping out cams and just a lot of issues. And that's the reason why, is because they were just security vehicles and they just idled through the parking lots. They didn't get run hard or anything. Mm-hmm. Actually, Kevin Waterman, he commented on it, the stunt driver.
Yeah.
He's had a few of them too. And he said, that's one of the worst things you can do for them is just let them sit and idle or just putter around the parking lots or whatever. I mean, they've actually got to be driven. That makes sense that the local hospital, you know, their cars, they were dropping engines left and right. So This car was a sheriff's department car. There's plenty of road rash on the bottom of the vehicle. So, you know, it may have got airborne a time or 12. The front end's a little loose. And it definitely was not idling. So
it was in hot pursuit. Here's why I bring this up. You may have heard here, Corndog. And now you're a thrifty man, but You are not immune to the effects of cool stuff. You'll spend money when you got to. What if I were to tell you that Holly had everything you need to do a swap of a Gen 3 Hemi into a 66 to 72 Mopar B-body? Just all of it. And what if I were to tell you that they even have exhaust? And let's play Can We Stump Corndog on Cheapness? So I'm going to pull up here exhaust for a 66 to 72 Charger, and I'm just going to throw this at you. What would you pay for a 2.5-inch full-length exhaust for your 66 Charger? Would you
long
pay?
Long tube? Are they ceramic? Are they polished? Or what are they?
These are 3 or 4 stainless.
Okay.
$3,000? $4,000. What would you throw at this?
Man, we'll go $1,500 because I'm cheap.
Okay, man. You are in for a deal. $870.95.
No. That's pretty good.
Now, I hear
and
you.
I did see them because when the Mo Party, the first Mo Party, I believe that red 66 Charger had them.
That's the test vehicle for it.
That was a beautiful car too.
What if I told you all the same stuff, but this time it's 3-inch exhaust, you know, for a little more fun?
I'd go $1,750 then.
Okay. You are close. It's $895.95.
Oh, yeah. Apparently I was one two sets. Obviously.
It's just the value that's killing you here. So it's not your fault. But they even have some tips, Hooker Blackheart tips that kind of look like factory Hemi tips to me. You know, kind of that the square fluted thing on there. That's really cool too. But I dig this stuff. I am definitely struggling with whether or not to do a Gen 3 swap in my generally or just do a stroker motor. I can't decide.
Well, I do remember looking at that 66 Charger, and after they said that that was their headers on it, I looked to see how they fit, because, you know, there's other brands that say they fit really well, but you do have to take a hammer to them every so often. Yeah. But those, they were like beautiful. They flowed well. They went around all the center link and everything. So they looked really nice as well.
So if you go to Holly, it's engine mounts, oil pans, headers, obviously exhaust, EFI fuel tanks, which you already have, radiators if you need that, accessory drives on the front, like the nice super tucked in ones that look like factory, alternators. Mm. It's a really cool setup. And the fact that you already have EFI on it, if you wanted to do something trick and run a carb style manifold instead, which is what I'm debating for myself, you totally could. So holly.com is where you go. Make sure that you tell them we sent you. They do have some deals going for Christmas here, but make sure that you check it today so that I don't misspeak. It's usually like a free shipping thing on a certain dollar order, somewhere over that.
Through Holly, you can essentially just start with a long block and just go from there.
Yeah, you totally almost. Could. That's not just Mopar related, although you know how we stand on stuff like that. But if you want to swap a GM anything, it's pretty cake at this point. LT motors are very common. They've got all that sorted out as well. I remember when the LTs came out, and that was the big debate is, man, what are we going to do about this power steering? It's all electric. It's all messed up. And then everybody solved that just like they always do, right?
Everybody's like, we got you. Voila.
Okay, well, let's go ahead and get to the Duke's review.
Just a good old boy, never meaning no harm.
This is an interesting one. This is the last episode of season 6. This is season 6, episode number 22, titled Cooter's Confession, written by Len Kaufman and Miles Wider, directed by Bob Sweeney, original air date March 24th, 1984. Snuck this one on a Saturday night for some reason. And here's the preview of it right here.
Tonight on the Duke. In hijacking hijinks.
You've been friend enough to me.
And Cooter's out on a limb.
Cooter Davenport.
Yeah, it is, it is.
Sounds like Luke's really in trouble.
I'm so glad you couldn't see that preview. You're about to hear some terrible, terrible news. Terrible news. Here's the IMDb summary. Corndog, you know. He knows.
Yeah, I know.
He can't say it.
Saying a prayer.
Jonas Jones, Cooter's friend and ex-convict, is falsely blamed for hijacking boss's expected shipment of automobile parts, which, of course, he plans to sell at inflated prices. Knowing that Jonas could spend years in prison for a crime he didn't commit, Cooter decides to take the fall. When they find out that the auto parts distributor is the front for a hijacking operation, the Dukes go undercover and infiltrate the scheme. Fine, 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 fine. Something was missing there. Here's the DVD summary. It doesn't matter either. Cooter didn't hijack that truckload of auto parts, so why did he say I did it? The Dukes reckon to find out. Okay, here's my summary. This is when it gets bad. This is when it gets real bad.
Was that how you titled it? The beginning of your summary? This is where it gets bad?
This is the beginning of the end. There's a lot I could tell you here. And the fact that I am under the weather right now isn't helping me. But this episode features the beginning of the end. Miniatures, people. Miniature buildings. Miniature cars. No, well, not miniature. Are there miniature people? Miniature
jokes. No, that was the last episode.
Oh, thank goodness. They did, in fact, release this on a Saturday night. Now we know why. The plot is irrelevant. What is important here is that we have to decide something. This will make you react in one of two ways. So I'm going to go ahead and play these for Corndog. Corndog, knowing all things about Dukes of Hazzard, will decide this. So Corndog, here is reaction number one, okay? Okay, that's reaction number one.
Short and sweet.
Yeah. Here's number two. Now, you're going to pick because, I mean, you're all knowing here. So let's try this one.
I know you're a little under the weather. Did you record that yourself?
I did not. These are right off the internet. That okay. Second one was pretty clever, though. Somebody placed a camera in the John, I think. Let's do the first one again. Just be safe here. What do you think? Barf or diarrhea?
I got some on me is what I think.
I think we'll go with the number two because I really think that you recorded that just before we started recording.
Oh, this one right here? Right about here. Yep.
Oh, one more.
One more.
Yeah, we'll go with that.
The miniatures are here. Oh, I'm so sad. I knew it was in one of the last episodes of season six. I just couldn't remember where. But now they have two generally fake jumps, two cop car fake jumps, and Roscoe's car goes through a building. And then we have one recycled real jump that starts the show out. And what kind of blows is that, you know, for the actors, there was nothing different about this for them. Because the way that they do all their work, they film all their scenes, like the second unit was out doing their own thing the whole time anyway. So yeah. For them, this was just another normal show. And they act well, and it's actually a decent story. Like, John and Tom are funny in this.
Yeah.
It's a good episode, except for that horrible, 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 horrible incident. I just hate it. Your thoughts?
The miniatures, they suck to watch. But like you said, the storyline was actually pretty good. And I was glad to see that Ben Jones was able to get more involved with an episode instead of just playing the couple lines here and there. I was glad to see that, you know, of course, granted it is called Cooter's Confession. So, you know, you get that, but you know, it's okay. I did like a lot of the driving scenes, the second unit and the camera work. That was like really good. I thought maybe that tried to help make up for the miniatures. I don't know.
Do you know the name of the miniature company?
No, it was Jack Sessoms. I can't pronounce his last name, but he built miniatures for Hollywood for everything. You know, he did Knight Rider, Fall Guy, Airwolf, tons of different TV shows. But I think even A-Team, maybe.
Probably.
But he did all of them. I believe they were like 1/8 scale. You know, they were pretty good size.
They weren't RC, were they?
No, they just had, it's just like a little die-cast car, basically. I mean, you know, just had two axles that would just spin. I mean, they really didn't have suspension on them. You can obviously tell on some of the landings once, I don't know that we see that in this episode, but on later episodes, you'll see that the axles and the wheels don't move up and down. I mean, it just bounces like a Hot Wheels would.
Like a toy car.
But no, they weren't RC, but they were pretty good-sized cars, and they would actually launch them by hand. They didn't do anything crazy. It's just like you get a Hot Wheels car or diecast car and you just grab it by your hand and roll it and there you go.
And they do some, you know, what would with real cars be more dangerous stunts. They jump over buildings, they jump through buildings, they jump over a flatbed train car in between two regular cars. Truly dangerous stuff. Not that the Dukes wouldn't do something like that and haven't. But it really is, for me, a sad thing because it's just the beginning of the end. Now, the episode is actually good other than that.
The thing that bothered me probably the most about the miniatures, you know, when they're jumping over houses and over water towers and all that, that I get it because it's kind of cartoonish at that point. That's not very realistic, you know. Mm-hmm. What bothered me the most was the simple drive-bys with a miniature. I thought, like on this episode, they've got the little flatbed truck. I think it was the F-350, whatever, with the stake bed on it, driving across the railroad tracks. They obviously had trucks that they were using for first unit and second unit. Why couldn't they have just recorded or filmed a truck driving across the railroad tracks? Yeah, the real one. Or the drive-by of the General Lee, you know, where all it does is just puts past the camera. And I thought, that's stupid to me that they would choose the miniatures to do that little simple drive-by instead of a real car. That's what got under my skin the most about the miniature stuff.
They'll have crazy jumps coming up in the field, like the Happy Birthday General Lee, which is the next technically episode we'll do next year, jumps through a drain pipe. At one point, they jump like onto a lower road on a flatbed semi with a bunch of tires on it. And the general lands with the tires and goes boing, 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 and it shoots up and over the truck and lands. I mean, it's
just like the Saturday morning cartoon.
So something interesting on this one. Jonas Jones is in it. The actor that plays Jonas Jones is Hal. What's Hal's last name? I don't have Hal's last name. Hal is a, he's been in like 9 or 10 hit TV shows. 227 was a show that he was in that, that was one that I really liked when I was a kid. His whole thing is he was a former roughneck in Oklahoma. So was Cooter. At one point, Cooter saved his life or vice versa. And Cooter feels that he owes him a debt. This guy had some, you know, troubles in his past legally. And when he gets hijacked, he doesn't want to admit it. So Cooter admits it. And the Dukes help him solve it. And that's the end. Did you see that they pulled out some vintage clothes for this one? When Bo and Luke are sneaking through the warehouse, they were, they're wearing their coats from like season one.
Right. John has the brown jacket, whatever you want to call it. You normally see it in High Octane and a few other episodes here and there. And like you said, Tom, I think he's got the denim jacket maybe.
Yeah, he does. In High Octane, they dress up to go meet with their
revenue agent.
That's one of the few times that you see them wear coats. That was interesting. I saw that they had an address that they were shipping all the J.D. Hogg's auto parts to. So I wrote it down. J.D. Hogg Auto Parts Company, P.O. Box 9140, Hazzard County, Georgia, 00965. That zip code is in Puerto Rico.
Priority mail doesn't deliver there.
Much less a P.O. box. It'd be really hard to get all those auto parts in a P.O. box, but what do I know?
What I thought was funny, too, is, you know, he's got the fully enclosed or stake bed. I can't remember which one it was at that time. The cargo area slammed full, but yet he needs room for one more crate. So we're going to sit it right here on the passenger seat of the truck. I thought that was kind
of
odd.
Yes, because his lunchbox got to go on top of that, and that's what falls out.
That's how they charge. I mean, they had the truck so full that they had to put some more in the front seat.
Burn, did you see this episode?
That would have been two in a row. No, sir.
Yep. Good. Okay. Don't bother is what we're saying.
Yeah.
Oh, man. How many episodes do we have left? Because season seven isn't really a full season.
We've got, looks like 17 episodes left in all of season seven.
We're going to have to stall. All right. So let's work on some movies. Let's go back and do some funniest episodes, greatest hits along the way. We got a lot of time to kill here, guys.
I know that you and Finnegan already reviewed Happy Birthday, General Lee, but you know, we still got to do it over. So there's one.
Because we didn't get your take on it. That's going to be pretty epic. I have a feeling
we hope
that for you, that is a very monumental and important episode.
You know, even though it's in the miniature era, it's still a very good episode.
Do you have
storyline was top notch. Except for the part where he says it's an old 68 coupe. That's the only part I didn't like.
All right, I was going to save this for you. Do you know who the guy is who says the beat up 68 coupe?
I'm terrible at that. After you say it, I may say, oh, yeah, I do remember that. But
old man no, Peabody from Back to the Future. My pines!
Really?
Yeah, that's him.
You space bastard! You killed my pine!
Oh.
Yeah.
Wow. Now I need to look at that.
Yeah. Do you happen to have your book of real General Lees for maintenance? Now, we damn well are not tracking maintenance on the models, the miniature cars, and I assume that that's not in there. But if it is, just ignore that part.
I hate to break the news to you, but no, it's not in here.
So thus far, since the season 6, episode 7, we started tracking real General Lees in Corndog's maintenance book that was created during the actual run of the series. Thus far, we have tracked 20 real General Lees. Several of which that have been totaled, several of which we know to be survivors, but they're not all documented yet. So do you have any on this episode?
Do. This would have been, there again, close to this time of year. I have it starting in December 16th. And these three cars, there's no notes next to it, just the fact that they were on the lot or whatever at the time when they first started filming. Car number 36, 28, and 78.
36, 28. What was the last one? 78?
78.
Ooh, I don't have that on the list.
Ah, there you go.
Bada bing. Okay. GL 78. Okay.
Nothing on the General Lees, but there's a, you know, body damage to one of the sheriff's cars, nondescript body damage, another nondescript with body damage. So, you know, that can be the car that the chicks broke down on the side of the road. That could have been something with hers. Mm-hmm. So, that was that on December 16th. Then we go to December 19th, and that's number 28, 78, 36 again. This time we've got car number 64, and it just says body damage.
64.
So that may be the car that was between the two police cars. It was Bo and Cooter in the car, and he says, hang on. He tells Cooter to hang on or whatever, and he throws it in reverse and slams it into the Enos's car, and then he goes forward and slams it into Roscoe's car. I don't know for a fact, but it just says body damage. So that may have been that car, car number 64.
Okay. That one says survivor on my list.
And the reason I was able to link it to this one, it's the last episode in the book for this year. Also, it has the one-ton stake bed truck. Okay. December 20th, car number 2878.
Yep.
And on this time, car number 78 got four tires and four tubes. Car number 32.
Yep, 32.
I don't know if it was having problems or what, but it got four fan belts.
That's a lot of fan belts.
Yeah, and paint damage. So it doesn't really say what kind of paint damage, but just paint damage and four fan belts.
Shim his pulleys the same way I did.
Yeah, they just kept rolling off and losing them on the road. Then car number 8, WGL08, did a mini jump. Okay. And then this one may be new on your list as well, WGL79.
That is new.
It also got four tires and four tubes, which could have possibly been, you know, it's Christmas time. My personal vehicle needs four tires and four tubes. I don't know. And then we've also got WGL13, radiator, belts, fan, and 5 quarts of oil. Okay. And then nondescript 85, just another random vehicle. It did a mini jump. Mm-hmm. That was on December 20th. That looks to be the end of it, but I don't know if this was, you know, wrapping up the season or what, but I found this to be pretty interesting. This was, I guess, like a summary of whatever he had on the lot at the time. I thought it was interesting. He had a sheriff's car number 15 to be wrecked. So WGL 67, he'd got four tires, four tubes. He wrote good by it and needs rear shocks and helper springs. 67, did you have that one already?
Yeah.
Okay. WGL 52 got one tire, one tube, and to be wrecked.
Ooh.
That's like a hit list right there, you know?
So the other general was to be wrecked? I thought that was a cop car.
The first one, sheriff's car, 15, was to be wrecked. But this was generally number 52 that got one tire, one tube, and to be wrecked. So this may have just been, you know, his list of, okay, this is what I'm looking at for next season or as we pick back up or what. Mm-hmm. And this car may have just been, it may have already started off as being pretty rough when they converted it into a generally, or maybe it was just a used up generally and finally they're going to ride it off one final time. And then we've got a generally number 36. It says good, but the frame is bent. Good. Sheriff's car number 71, which has a 440 in it. He's got good by it. Generally number 76, he has good. Generally 57.
Wait, which is 76?
76.
Mm-hmm. I don't have that one.
That is Frank's car.
I must have had that mislabeled on here somewhere. I know that I had that one on here.
But it may have not appeared on your, you know, since you've been keeping records. But 76 says good. Generally number 57 says he just has frame. Doesn't say anything about the frame. Just says frame and hole in the oil pan. One too many mini jumps. Then generally number 64 just says frame, bad. That's all. Frame, bad.
Okay.
And if I remember right, 64 is a survivor.
It is. Yeah, you've indicated that already on this one.
Yeah. And then number 35, that's the ski car. WGL 35, 318, okay, alignment, rear springs. Probably putting it up on two wheels, probably tweaked the leaf springs. And either they replaced them or just re-arched them or who knows what. Generally, number 28, mount car, M-O-U-N-T, mount car. I don't know what that's supposed to mean. For a camera mount? Maybe.
Mount car.
Mount car, okay, needs gearbox. Yeah, power steering gearbox is what it needs. So it's probably puking out power steering fluid, which is common for any Chrysler. And then just WGL-08, and it doesn't have any notes on there. So that was to wrap up the series for the year, I guess. Just his overall notes for Christmas break, I guess.
What was the date on there?
That did not have a date, but I would assume it was either the 21st or shortly thereafter of December.
What year? 1984?
Should be 83.
Okay.
Yeah, because it picks back up. The next bit of notes actually is June 21st of 84. So either he went a spell without keeping records, or they did not do anything until June.
Sounds like it, because I know that the final episode was filmed like around Christmas time.
Yeah. Yeah, and you could tell too by the way they're dressed. They're in warm clothes.
Yeah. What do you think of our review, Byrne?
I'm sorry, what?
Oh, okay. Appreciate it, Byrne.
Wake up.
Yeah.
You got too comfortable at home.
Just be working on the news for next week. That's all that matters. Okay, speaking of next week, we need a Christmas movie. So we will take your suggestions. You can send them in. We always have some of our favorites. I have several that I like, but they're not really car related. Do you guys have any in particular that you really desperately want to hit? So we've done Christmas Vacation. We have done Ralphie. We have done the Dukes of Hazzard Christmas.
Speak for yourself. I haven't done Ralphie.
Take it easy.
Wow. I like to do Uncle Buck, but it's not a Christmas movie.
It's not.
And I don't think he would like
it. And it only has one car.
Yeah, Home Alone would be a stretch. We could do Fred Claus, but there's no car in it. We need a Christmas movie. Hardcore Christmas movie. Send in your suggestions, and between now and then, we'll figure out something if we have to as well. But next
even week, if the car's just driving by while they're in the grocery store.
Yeah. Yeah, totally, for sure. All right, everybody, you have survived all the way to the end of the show. Make sure that you go to patreon.com/KF show if you'd like to get in and help us do a little extra contribution for Toys for Tots this year. We would love to do that with you. Again, you can do something one time only. That's totally cool and totally fine. You can get this show on Apple Podcasts. Please leave a rating there. Make sure that when you buy your parts from Holly for Christmas, you tell them that we sent you. Bells, anything else before we go?
I learned a fact, since we're all foodies, that not only is it good stuff to know because we're foodies, but it's a bit of a history lesson as well. We all love French fries, right?
Sure.
And yeah. The myth is that they were born and first cooked in France.
Okay.
That's a myth. They were cooked in Greece.
We're getting too comfortable with each other. It's too much.
Imagine if we liked each other.
Imagine if we did. I'm going to save that one. That's a good reply to different jokes. All right, fellas, I will see you later. Everybody, thanks for listening. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.
Later.
The Kibbe and Friends Show, brought to you by our good friends at Holly Performance. Click the link on our show page and visit holly.com for everything air, fuel, and performance related for your ride. Connect with us on the socials and at patreon.com/KAFS. See you next week. Later on.
I got to check it out from Capital City, if y'all excuse me. I appreciate it.
You know, Enos, I bet you would have caught that hijacker, weren't for that woman driver.
No funny, Bob.
Well, bless her heart, she was probably so scared she couldn't get out of the way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Thanks a lot, fellas. I appreciate it.
Ah, there we go.
I'll bet this means I'm going to do the shopping by myself, huh?
Yep.
There is no justice.
Thanks,
none.
Shaman.
Yeah. Oh,
it does
on.
Take both of us to take this in.
Yes, it does.
Coda, you listen to me now.
Yeah.
You're gonna rot in jail for 5 years. You hear that?
Or even less.
Got hit by a damn girl.
Again?
Luke, what the heck did you do this time?
How's it going, Cooter?
Yeah, same to you.
Got him.
Here's old Slugger. Now, what about the other one?
Figure Uncle Jesse and Daisy got him under control.
Them hijackers got locked up, and Flash had to guard them. Because when Boss found out that his truckload of auto parts was impounded for evidence, he had to order another truckload from an honest distributor. Cash money in advance. Again.
Well, Cooter, I don't really know how to thank you.
Hey, y'all, you know, that is exactly what I said to him when he pulled me out of that fire out there in Oklahoma. You just make a good life for yourself, and that'll be plenty of thanks.
And you Dukes is something else, doing what you did for a stranger.
Well, that ain't exactly right.
You ain't no stranger.
Yeah, Uncle Jesse has a saying about it.
The way we figured, Jonas, a stranger's just a friend we've never met.
Been interesting.
You know, somebody ought to write a country song about that. But I can't think of a word that rhymes with hazard.
you.